Just get down. Oh. Because they're perfect peace. Sit in the mode for they shall be comforted.
I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, he dies. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die. We bless the name of Jesus. Our hope in him when we all get to heaven. Sing the wondrous love of Jesus, his mercy and his grace.
Honor you, we praise you by your holy name. So God, we ask for the presence of your Holy Spirit in our midst today. Thank you. We bless you. We ask for your blessing upon this service today. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. And now I can officially say, good afternoon, friends, families, relatives. Good afternoon. Sound like three people actually. I said it again. Good afternoon to everyone who's here. That's a lot better. Praise God. Welcome. Today we are here to join in the celebration for the life of Mrs. Pearl Olive Pringle. And as you go along, you will hear she was affectionately called Miss Olive and also Mama. All right, so those are the names you might hear. What I am here, and I realize, death has a way of bringing together people who haven't seen each other for a long time. Well, I'm right. Exactly. And I'm pretty sure some of you haven't seen this other since you left here. Might be some people who haven't seen her, and this is the last time you're actually seeing her physically. But because of her life and the celebration, we're all joined together. Celebrate the life that she lived. So let's just enjoy the celebration. All right, we have a limited program, so we're going to run right into the program right now. And we're going to have the first lesson that is going to be read. And we're going to call one of her grandsons, Mr. Labaris Pringle, to come and read for us. The lesson is from 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Be reading from verse 51-57.
The first reading is taken from 1 Corinthians 15, verses 51-57. I'll give you a couple seconds if you want to follow along. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall all be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal put on immortality. So when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, which giveth us of the victory, through our Lord Jesus Christ. Here then the reading of God's holy word.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Mr. Tavares, for reading the first lesson. I'm sure of you
Thank you. Zoom in for the whole. You get the book?
The older I got, the more I respected Mom. But with much determination and self-confidence, developed social and life skills that enabled her to accomplish much in her lifetime, including raising six children. I often wonder how she did it. Some of us did not like hard, some did not eat pork, others ate rice and peas. Whatever the nuances, she kept us satisfied and showed us her love every day by doing her best to feed, clothe, and educate our large family. I particularly remember, besides how she made all the laughter meals, and after Sunday school or church, all eight of us would sit at a table that was formally set and would have dinner together. And that was where she taught us social grace and skills. She was never a single mother, but she did most of the nurturing because of her dad was out of work. However, she would bring incidences that she thought he needed his attention, like once when I hopped the ice truck or when Pops and Clive were misbehaving. But together, they gave me an unpredictable, wonderful childhood. Mama cultivated communities wherever she went. She made you feel loved, important, and that you mattered. Her smile drew you to her. Whether it was a baby or an adult, whether you were known or known to her, it didn't matter. She was warm and caring. To paraphrase Maya Angelou, people will forget what you said. People will forget what you did. But people will never forget how you made them feel. And she always made kind and one of the most generous people I've known. She was extraordinarily supportive of her family, friends, and the wider community. She had a remarkable way of finding something to give or to share with you. It was not unusual for her to be going to the doctor, the hairdresser, the senior center, or the church, and she had to find something, whether it's from the backyard or some of her big or change or fear or war. She nurtured her community and was very positive. Even in later years when she was a headmaster, she would cook and have us children, grandchildren, neighbors and friends over to spend time with. Even towards the end, her smile and her warmth still conveyed her hospitality and her love. She was grateful for life. She prayed and she thanked the Lord. Her usual words in the morning were, "Thank you, Lord." When she could no longer remember the words, prayers, or songs, I would say them, and she would have this beautiful smile on her face as she said, "Yes, yes," to believe the words. She lived a meaningful life. She helped people, and she didn't count the cost or keep score. I was very proud to see her participation in life and the contentment with the experiences that she shared. Mama was always present. I used to think she had eyes in the back of her head. If you were being honest, she could tell. Once I was trying to run away to see the couple one Sunday morning, I could not even accomplish my goal. She knew I'd left. Should we be parents with proper water? She said, their lives were. You needed to know what was happening in our lives. I remember you standing on the tree as you are today. You were an early poet. You were so well put together. As you always are, standing well put together. I have so many memories. Who were never part for a long time. I have so much to say, but simply, Mama, thank you for the beauty of God. You have faith in me. Move me and the faith brings to God. Thank you for being my kind, sweet, elder mother who made me proud. You helped me along the road of life. For many others, your auntie, your Miss Mary, your very Alison, or whoever you want to be, what happens was when you remember I was your daughter, and you introduced me as this is my daughter.
You have three. said, you are true. And I said, you know, you are true. Because it's really, it's near and dear to many of us. And I'm happy for the opportunity of our God's song to say a few words at this time. Olive, Pearl, Miss Pretty, Miss Olive, Mom. Whatever the name, it's all over this wonderful woman who we pay tribute to today. It's a celebration of life, 98 plus. My meeting Miss Olive was destined. I met her as a toddler, and I can't remember my first memory. But this happened after my mom and her bumped into each other while they were recuperating in the hospital. The two had an instant connection. Ironically, my mom made the condo, and there was a second connection as Miss Olive's dear husband, Kenneth, was also my father's cousin. As I grew older, I understood why these two women had this connection between them. They were from the same, they were cut from the same cloth, so to speak. I was fortunate to have had her as a godmother, in every respect, my childhood days made her out to be no more, no less than a fair godmother in many respects. I remember stopping by the house with my parents on many occasions to say hello. Her house was made a home. You want to understand what I'm saying here? Through her dedication, that we do both in fire and in water. I was always greeted with a big, broad, deep smile. She stood out not only because she was the shortest person in the family, but also because it was obvious that she really respected one another. She had earned and commanded the respect of the entire family. It was obvious that she ran when we kept home. There was always something sacred or sweet, ready to be popular or low. Despite the energy of four girls and two boys, our house was always well kept, well together, well organized. As I grew, I realized that she was very similar to my own mom, and that was her connection to me from her children. Don't have this to her. We don't understand that those women that are here. But one that grew up respect of a key figure of authority that had the best intentions of the family. Sometime during my teenage years, the family migrated. She went first to the United States by the and eventually the temple on the moon. It did not create a relationship that I have with her, and the care of God's persona grew even stronger. I was always amazed that for the days when we did not have email, or much less voice calls or video calls. You had to send letters. I was amazed at how she always knew exactly what to do. Not only that, she would not have seen me for a year or two, and whatever she sent me was the perfect gift. I recall when I started to travel to America as a young man. One of the toughest items on my list was to visit her to spend some time with her. Surprise. As could be expected, I found most of all of the same bubble, strongly disciplined individual, and energetic as could be. By that time, our children were grown, but it was that same loving respect that we see from her grandchildren. Additionally, she had kids from the neighborhood she took care of, and I knew that this place was special because of how she started her life. Her house had changed. They gave the home to me the same. A place of sweet calm serenity that you could come home back at the harbor and be at peace. Needless to say, our children didn't have to do that every evening. They stopped by on the way to their own home to spend the evening before our meeting. Such is the nature of this life. There's no doubt that she would be missing. But to the family, I would say this. Her legacy lives in you. I seated every single one of her six children. In her hearts and minds, she has programmed the love, joy, happiness that comes from hard work, dedication, and it's the simplest but valuable things in life. Her influence is obvious in the way you love your own family. You sound like you are a special person who has touched the life of many people here today. But your values are gone. May your soul rest in peace, and your values will be eternal. Your children, grandchildren, and extended family, from generations to come.
and forgive for me.
Each other and everybody would jump on. So she watched us for a while, for a couple couple of days we were doing more weight, more weight. And I think we broke one of our bodies. So she watched us the other night to see if we were going to do that. So we started more weight, and all we could feel is some whipping on our backs. Because she was there watching us. Because for her, it wasn't what she wanted us to. I'll not forget, she respected all the elders in our community. And I don't know if you're from Alleppo or Elliott, there was a little lady just up the road from us there. I think she was Miss Blair, was her name. So there was a stream that ran up the road. So some of us as kids, one afternoon, went to play in the water. And we were there playing and playing. Obviously, we were disturbing her. So she took her time, went down to Mama, told Mama we were disturbing her, and we only heard that rocks was coming from off the road on us. Mama was throwing us out of the river because we were disturbing one of the elders. That was Mama. I can also remember her coming from America, and she visited me before she came to the country. So my son, who did ask me for a while, was, Mama, Mama, do you know how to dance the dollar line? She could have said no. She could have said yes, but she said no. So he proceeded to show her where to rock, where to rock, and want to pull the line, what she needed to do. That was Mama. Mama loved her grandchildren. She took them from place to place. When we as adults were busy working, she took them to New York on the plane to see their and meet their great grandmother. She gave them their first train ride, as Sasha would say. It was nice riding on that train. She took them in a taxi that they had never been in. She took them riding on a city bus that we had no time to do. She found the time. And for summer, it was filled with kids. She bought all the fun stuff at Christmas, and she was there with her kids, teaching them all the dance. Skiaf, skiaf, skiaf. She took them shopping to the mall, because that was something she loved to do, shopping. Every Saturday, that was one of her pet peeves. Mama, we will miss you. But we are consoled that Papa was here waiting for you with a smile. Say, Olive, I love you. Welcome home.
Back when I was a child, I remember my mama would sing to me. She'd heal my pain with her smile. Oh, how that she meant everything to me. I wish that I could have my mama. Even for a minute, Lord, I'd take that. But I know for sure she is love. But if I could get another chance, another smile, another hug from her, I'd hold her tight and I'd never let go. Oh, Mama, do you know how much I miss you so? Oh, Mama.
Mama was her name. Her was her name. Thank you.
joy and peace. However, this life is not ordinary. So let us be thankful that in a life that is to come, there shall be no more death, nor sorrow, nor evil cry. I met Mrs. Pringle in November 1970 when I came in the area to live and work. It was no coincidence that the house which my husband lived in was next door to that of the Pringles. I found Mrs. Pringle to be a good neighbor. She was pleasant and very welcoming to my family. She helped us to fit in and settle after a short while. Her entire family welcomed us. It wasn't long afterwards that we became friends. Mrs. Pringle was a good homemaker. She was always willing to share her knowledge and skills with others. Her home was always home to my family members, as well as mine to her. When my sons were small, she showed me how to cut and sew their pajamas. She was good at painting and willing to show others, including myself, how it was done. I remember when, those Saturday mornings, when we would go to the supermarket in Richmond, our means of transportation was Mr. Pringle's truck. How can I forget those evenings when the families would enjoy an evening at the beach at Robinsville. We shared many things together then, but not our faith. Clonmel Baptist Church planned its annual crusade in March. I invited her, and she accepted. There, she accepted the Lord as her Savior and was baptized and became a member of this church. No, she wasn't on the right way, but my sister in the Lord. She could be depended on to do her part when we planned harvest supper on the tea party. She became a member of the Women's Federation, where we would have fun and fellowship together. Socials were also a regular activity at some of the meetings. She always had a longing to accomplish more in life than in the. She thought about academic studies. I remember telling her that whatever she thought, would try to do the best she can. The opportunity came for her to visit Canada. Sometime afterwards, she started visiting the United States of America. By this time, her children were grown and were pursuing their different occasions. She was always happy to assist with the care of her grandchildren. She migrated to the United States of America sometime after, and her family followed. During her visits home, which were usually short, she would send her tithe to the church. This time, I always called her on her birthday. One birthday when I called, there was no answer. When I inquired, I was told about her feelings. Her daughter, her granddaughter, would be crying of her feelings, which continued to her. People, we are visitors to this planet, and in whatever capacity we find ourselves existing, there is a common road at destination. This led life should therefore be cherished. Therefore, remind us that it was led and not.
Reminder of the profound impact that one individual can have on
the lives of others. Although Mama is no longer physically with us, she will never leave us, as her impact and spirit will continue to guide and inspire us. Just as Mama was, will continue to shine brightly in our lives. Despite the pain of losing her, we find solace in the knowledge that she has left an indelible mark on the hearts of many. Our dear Mama will always be remembered. Her memory will be cherished and will continue to bring us comfort and joy. After a life well spent, it is now time for another gem to take her rest. May her soul rest in peace. Pray.
Amen. Now let me say something here that can disturb sometimes. You can hear somebody talk and say something. You feel like somebody warms up, doesn't feel like a warm up. Right? You experience this, I can say, I've heard those tributes about there's a spring. Unless somebody in the congregation might be wondering, who is that young man? There's a spring. He has her grandson in law. I was accepted by Mrs. Quick. Yes, you probably that was my grandson in law. Now, my wife, who is her granddaughter, we grew up together, going to Sunday school, church, school together. And this is just my introduction. My wife is a father, and I never know her. Only here I'm a father. About her grandmother. But when I came to actually meet Mrs. Pringle, I could very well understand why my wife was always yes, I'm telling you the truth. Yes. And you know sometimes, just to have this way, sometimes you have a funeral of services. And folks come up and they give tributes. A lot of people in the congregation know the Wednesday. No, no, what's up? But nobody will think about it and say, you don't like that now? Yes, I won't do that. But let me tell you this. But maybe about, we know, 2024. Let's say about 30 years. I knew Mrs. Pringle. Everything that was said up here, barring the time before I knew her, I can attest very much true. Nothing was said that anybody would give up a life and death. No. Mrs. Pringle was that kind of person. So we give that to those who came up and paid. No, this is wrong. Oh, let me tell you quickly. Another thing that I found fascinating with Mrs. Pringle, I gave the number and realized she was a member of the Clonmel Baptist Church. Now, for those who know me, I grew up with a lady named Miss Puto. Gloria Living. She's my aunt. She was also a member here at Clonmel Baptist Church. When Mrs. Pringle found out that that's the person I grew up with, I can begin to tell you some of the conversations we had. When, that's what before she really got her illness to some of her. But it was a pleasure for me to sit and reason as we said. With Mrs. Pringle, come here, child. bit back then. But she remembered the school and had good conversations before she did. But she was chair. We can draw a little bit. This is the author of him that we're going to sing, but before we sing it, I'm going to call her Sister Papa Spence. She is one of the selection. After which, dig deep in your pocket. And if you don't have a pocket, make one with the four with God. And you dig deep because of your pocket. God's money is not your money. God's money. And give back to God. Alright?
Let us all pray. Loving God, giving God, eternal God, we thank you for how you have blessed us today with this beautiful day, bright sunshine. We thank you for the night of your saint, Sister Pringle, and we thank you for all who have come to pay their respects and to extend their love and appreciation for her life. We thank you more so for her family, and we ask that you continue to give them your love and your assurance that you are there for them. And as we give back a portion of what you have blessed us, we ask for your blessing on it and may it be used to the furtherance of your kingdom here on earth. As we ask these and other mercies in Jesus' name. Amen.
I'm a pilgrim on my way, going to glory land. Jesus, I only hope that day, hold me by the hand. He is a joy to understand, think I'm in with you. Leave with my promise to the Lord, I'm going through. I'm in.
Let it all make you my God.
minister, so Mr. Trevor Meek, is going to read or come and give us the eulogy for his dear sister.
Thank you for being here. We could have used this glorious afternoon with me yesterday. And we are so thankful. Thank you for taking the time to be here. You've heard a lot about the reason why we are here. My sister was passed. Today we celebrate her life. Today we celebrate the life of a passionate, elegant, authentic, resilient, loyal daughter, sister, aunt, wife, mother, grandmother, great grandmother. She was affectionately known as Sis. Aunt Olive. Miss Olive. Sister Olive. Dolly Sweet. Sweet Rose. Captain and her son's daughter. And her. Her lady aunt. Olive Fairweather was born in Alleppo, St. Mary, Jamaica, October 16, 1932, to Eric Fairweather and Mary Marshall. She was raised by Icilda and Thaddeus Mullholand. She's the second of 12 children. However, Dita, Evelyn, Kenneth, Harry, and Effer preceded her. She attended Clonmel Baptist School. During her late teens, she moved back to her hometown, where she briefly became a nanny to the children of Vivian Jones, school headmaster. Soon after, she met Kenneth Pringle. As her alumni started, she started their only family. The unit was later, was lasted for 57 years. Imagine that. Lifetimes of love. 57 years until he died in 2008. Secretly, the union produced 6 children. Cynthia, Kenneth, Clive, Marjorie, Marcia, and Diana. All whom she made her life. Came from a humble living, and even though she could not fulfill her dreams of formal education, she was very industrious and taught herself social and life skills that made her an outstanding member. Among other things, she was one of the best cooks I can attest to. entered and won gold medals, another award in the Jamaica Festival Competition several times. She was also very active in Parent Teachers Association, their church. In the community, she mentored girls and fed and made most delicious cakes, pastries, and roti. She was a fashionista. She knew how to dress herself, and she came as she could sew for her family. She could always be depending on her. She was kind, considerate, and loving, and her generosity was accepted. Everyone felt welcome at her home and always ensured that they never left empty-handed. She gave much, and she also required much. She expected decency and good behavior. She ensured that her children went to Sunday school, church, school. She ensured they realized their full potential. She never spared the rod and spoiled the child, nor condoned wrongdoing. Her nurturing was marrowed to the children's bones. Later, when the grandchildren and great grandchildren came along, she never feared. At the age of 40, after her three youngest children were settled in high school, she started exploring her dream of traveling the world. She dragged the love of her life along with her, and they went to Canada and London. And then, in the mid-1980s, she and Kenneth migrated to New York. After 2 years, they were joined by the children of her children. She settled in Florida, where she worked initially as a caregiver for elderly, and then came the full circle of her favorite job, nurturing children. began to face her share of health challenges and had to rely on her children to assist and support her as she began the new chapter. She continued to rely on her faith and appreciate the care of many doctors and frequent visits from neighbors and friends. Her had several hospitalizations, always fought the odds, and came back home to continue the light and joy in her life. Sadly. And I mean sadly. On Wednesday, February 21st, 2024, she was not able to bounce back this time for her hospitalization, and instead of continuing back to her physical home, she went to her spiritual. During her final moments, she was surrounded by her children, grandchildren, great-grandchildren, and the love and the pain in heaven. The matron of the left us physically, but the life she left remains an invaluable legacy. Friends, I'm there. She was a survivor of the warrior, and her strength came from the Lord. We beat our faith. Let us remember. She died, is saved, she lived by. She survived. And her children, great children, brothers, sisters, nephews, nieces, in-laws, neighbors.
Thank you, Mr. Nick, for reading the eulogy. The ceremony held a selection from Miss Audrey Williams, after which, man of God is going to come and give us a message that God has given to tell us. Selection by this morning. Amen. And Cousin Audrey said she went to the home and then she went to the church that Miss Olive used to go. She was told she don't come here anymore. You're going to Miss Olive's house now. Not here anymore. But here's a good thing. You know where she is? Somewhere around that road. Now, if you want to see Miss Olive again, we have to go. We have to go around that road. Now, for directions as to how you can go around that road. Yeah. You know the direction. He's here now. And he's going to come. Not coming to Miss Alice. She can hear it. He's going to talk to you as the call. You can come around. Stop. It's a great pleasure. I hereby present to you Dr. Isaac Brown.
Good afternoon, everyone. On behalf of the Brown's family and Mr. Phillips, we'd like to express sincere sympathy to the members of the Pringle family. We know it is very challenging. It is indeed a very, very difficult time. And as a consequence, we're praying for you. I've heard my friend and brother, Colin, just bragging here a while ago that he is a member of his family. And oh, he is the husband, wife, and daughter of this wonderful family. Marjorie and I have been in school and married to become a Jewish at that time. Perhaps if I was a sharp man, a sharp no, I would be standing in the sun now. But that perhaps was not the will of the Lord. I don't know. I feel as if I'm a doctor. And I should not be feeling this way when someone is gone home to be with the Lord. Talk to me, you understand me? If you die, if you accept Christ before you die physically, then you will be living forever. But when I get the vibe that you come to a place where your dear sister is gone for everybody. And I'd like for us to come out of that move. But let me just ask you, if you have a Bible study very briefly. Say Luke chapter 24, we're reading from verse 13 to 19. And behold, two of them went that same day to a village called Emmaus, which was from Jerusalem about 60 furlongs. And they talked together all the things which had happened. And it came to pass that while they communed together and reasoned, Jesus drew near and went with them. But their eyes were holding that they should not know him. Then one of them, whose name was Caiaphas, answered and said unto him, art thou only a stranger in Jerusalem, and hast not known the things which are talked about there in these days? Verse 19. And he said unto them, what things? They said unto him concerning Jesus of Nazareth, which was a prophet mighty in deed, that wrote before God the all the people. This is the word of the Lord. Father, we thank you for your word.
which is all I'd like to imagine. We ask that you open our hearts and our understanding as we seek to hear from you either. We ask it in Jesus. I'd like to talk to you today very briefly on a topic that has three words. It's called a sweet conversation. Might like you to stand here by this time. You've been sitting for a while, so you need to have the circulation going, so that by the time we're ready to leave, we don't have to eat the other way. Take any matter of it to eat together.
Very happy to talk with Jesus. Tell him about each other. You really hear the biggest cry. And you that's why when you see the sunrise.
Jesus, all our sins and grief to bear. What a privilege But while you're going through this grief, this challenging moment in your life, Jesus has drawn you. He understands what is happening to you, and he's a part of your journey. Are you ready now? But then secondly, Jesus Paul with them. And so he asked him a question, what is it that has caused you to look so sad? And he said, me. Are you strength that you don't understand what happened here? You don't hear that they crucified Jesus. And that we thought that he would have come to rescue Israel. And so he's dead now 3 days and then we don't know what happened. And they say not in the tomb. And they were describing the event that took place in Jerusalem. But Jesus started to talk to them now. And he explained to them everything that happened in prophecy. He talked to them about Moses. And how Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness and he was social, the Son of Man with himself. And so he carried them to Genesis chapter 3, where it says that the seed of the woman was going to bruise the serpent's head, but the serpent was going to bruise his ear. And so the conversation got nicer and nicer. We're talking about a sweet conversation. And then when they got to a point where they entered Elliott, that Jesus acted as if he was going to continue on his journey. Then they spent the time in Forrester. It's getting late. So you know what? Stay with us. Don't bother to leave us. Stay until tomorrow because it's getting a little dark. But Jesus accepted their invitation. They made room for Jesus, and that's a critical point. And I'm saying to you, in your time of grief and disappointment, it is important that you make room for Jesus. Are you ready? He stayed with them. You know the words you were saying, my